Hello, Dr. Yasufuku. How are you?
Very good. How are you, Nadia?
I'm good. Thank you for your time today. It's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Kazuhiro Yasufuku, who is Professor of Surgery at the University of Toronto, Staff Thoracic Surgeon at the Division of Thoracic Surgery at Toronto General Hospital. He is also the Director of the Interventional Thoracic Surgery Program at the University Health Network. So, Dr. Yasufuku, we know that you have been a leader in the field of minimally invasive diagnostics and therapeutics for thoracic malignancy, and you have been conducting research on development of new technologies in early diagnosis and ultra-minimally invasive thoracic surgery. One of the minimally invasive procedures to treat lung cancer, we learned that you can use a surgical robot called Davinci system, and the Davinci surgical system consists of multiple arms that are controlled and manipulated by the surgeon to make small incisions in the patient's body, and it helps to treat the early stage lung cancer. We know that there are some pros and cons of the Davinci surgical system, so would you like to explain a little bit about it?
Thank you, Nadia. I think the question is the pros and cons of the robotic platform. And maybe I'll just start out with a little history of robotics for, especially for lung cancer in Canada. So in 2011, so this is 10 years ago, in October, I was the first thoracic surgeon to actually apply robotics for lung cancer surgery in Canada. It had started, several years ago. Prior to that, in the US and around the world, but especially for Canada, we were the first to introduce this. So I've been using the technology for about 10 years. And in simple words, the robotic enhances the surgeon's ability to do surgery in a minimally invasive way. So traditional surgery used to be where we make a big incision, we open the chest, and we can put, our hands in. Touch everything and do the surgery. But things have changed significantly in the past 20 years, where the majority of the surgeries that we do, we try to avoid making big incisions. That's good for our patients because they recover quickly, they have less pain. But what is important is that when we try to make smaller incisions and try to do a similar surgery from outside, it becomes very challenging. So we started out with, we call it VAT surgery or video assisted thoracoscopic surgery, where we place a camera, we hold the camera, we insert instruments, and we basically move our instruments from outside to do the surgery. But you can kind of imagine it's not very easy. So the robot actually enhances the capability of surgeons to move the instruments. It moves in different angles and in different degrees. So it's almost like having your hand inside of the patient. Da Vinci system also has a 3D view. So you're actually now, you can see everything in 3D, which also enhances the surgeon's ability to do surgery. So I think that's probably the biggest benefit of the Da Vinci. And the way that it's made, you can actually do the surgery through smaller incisions than the traditional VAT surgery, which means that the patient will have smaller incisions and they may have less pain. So those are kind of the pros of the robotic surgery. The con, there's not a lot of cons, but I would say that cost of the robot is an issue, especially in the Canadian healthcare system, because it's all paid by tax money, right? And typically robotic surgery, if you look at the surgery itself, it is more costing than using the traditional instruments. It costs a couple of million dollars to buy the robot, and every time you do the surgery, the instruments you can only use so many times, so there's a cost of using each instrument, and also the maintenance fee is pretty tremendous. Think about owning a car, right? You buy a car, and that's not it. You have to maintain the car. Similarly, you buy the robot, and that comes with the cost. But other than that, I think it's really a great tool for treating patients.
Thank you for sharing your thoughts. So based on the information you have provided, what is your motivation behind practicing robotic surgery?
Well, I think as I mentioned, you know, it does enhance the ability of the surgeon to do a very precise surgery. I think you mentioned that robotic is used for early stage, but actually with the robotic, you can actually do more advanced disease surgery where traditionally you may have to open. You know, with the robotics, you can do it pretty well, very safely. The reason why I started robotic surgery, you know, was because of this, but also I see a future of robotic surgery because technology continues to get better and better. And if you do not, you know, use the technology, you're going to be left behind. So I think we, you know, constantly have to look at what is available in the new technology and how we can apply it to our patients.
That's really inspiring. Thank you for sharing your thoughts. I guess you kind of answered this question earlier too, but when do you prefer to do robotic surgery over the conventional procedure like an open surgery?
Open surgery, we will pretty much only do open surgery when it's necessary. For instance, if it's a big tumor or if it's for a procedure like a lung transplantation where there is no option to do minimally invasive surgery. For patients that have advanced stage disease, where typically we had to do open surgery, the robot actually allows us to still do the surgery in a minimally invasive way.
So when you perform robotic surgery, is there anyone in the OR or operation room to specifically take care of the machine? Like, how do you handle the situation when there is an issue with the robot itself?
So when you get training to do robotic surgery, obviously you need to know, you know, if there are like emergencies where the robot malfunctions, you need to know all of that. And all of the members of the, you know, OR, they need to know. So when I started this, you know, we had to go out for training. We would go out training with specific OR nurses. So everyone who is involved, you know, is aware of what to do in emergencies or if there is any malfunctioning. There is a robotic coordinator or robotic nurse. It's a real nurse, not a robot, but you know, she kind of oversees all of the robotic surgeries. And you know, she is the kind of dedicated nurse that can kind of troubleshoot and everything. And there's always a medical engineer from the company that provides the Davinci. So there's always someone that's assigned to our Toronto General Hospital OR so that if there is any issues, you know, they're available and they can kind of help us.
That's good to know. Have you ever encountered any difficulties using the Davinci system?
I'm very meticulous and I'm very careful with what I do. I try to prepare well in advance. So in the 10 years I've been doing robotic surgeries, I have had zero issues.
That's wonderful.
Yeah. And I've never had any, you know, significant emergencies as well. And it's not just for robotics, but, you know, you have to prepare for everything, right?
Yeah, I was going to say it's a lot of your preparation that leads into like zero issues.
Yeah.
I see. Just like surgical robots develop and improve with advancement of technologies over time, people are slowly getting to know that there are robots that help surgeons to perform better in surgeries. But I'm sure there are some people who are still hesitant to go through robotic surgery or simply cannot trust the robots to perform such an important procedure. What is the one thing you would like to or you always tell your patients when guiding them through different types of procedures? How do you present information to your patients?
That's a great question. And when we talk to our patients, you know, we have to explain to them what surgery is about, you know, what we're going to do. Then we start discussing about the different approaches, you know, in details. So you're not going to say, okay, we're going to do robotic surgery for you. And, you know, as a patient, if you hear robotic surgery, you might imagine, oh, so you're not going to do the surgery. The robot's going to do the surgery itself, but you know, that's not true. So as long as you explain to the patient well the difference of the different approaches and what robotic surgery is about, no patients in the past 10 years have been hesitant to go ahead with surgery, with robotic surgery. the robot will not even move unless we move the robot, right? The surgeon is responsible in moving the actual robot. So if they get a wrong perception of what robotic surgery is about, they may not feel comfortable. But at you know, as long as you explain to them what it's about, I've had no patients, you know, so far. And in fact, a lot of the patients come to see me because they prefer having the robotic surgery. Even if they do come wanting robotic surgery, I also always explain about the different approaches.
You always provide as much information as possible to guide them through informed decision, I guess.
Of course.
That was very, very informative. How do you foresee the next coming 10 years? Would you like to see more or less robots in healthcare?
Right now, there's many robotic platforms that are being developed. So right now, it's the Davinci, right? Intuitive Surgical, they have the Davinci, and that is dominating the market. But there are other players that are coming out. For instance, Medtronic is coming out with a new robot called the Hugo. And we at UHN, we have the robot, you know, in our training center. And Johnson & Johnson, they've been working with Google, and they came up with a company called Verve Surgical. When you see different companies making new robots, that's a good thing because it does drive the cost down, hopefully. And when you have competition, you know, the technology will always become better. And in terms of the technology, when you look at the past 10 years, it's developed so much. You know, there's AI incorporated. So, you know, I think it's going to continue to get better and better in terms of the robotic platform. But as a surgeons, we need to make sure we can keep up with that technology. So it's going to be continuing education for us.
I see. Do you think surgical robots will benefit some populations who do not have adequate access to healthcare and rely on remote healthcare? Do you think robots in healthcare have potential to do so?
Interesting question, because do you know the history behind the Davinci robot? It was actually the U.S. Army who tried to incorporate this technology so that, you know, they can apply this for soldiers that are kind of fighting on the, you know, on the battlefield. That was the initial thought of the Davinci, and now the Davinci is where it is now. It is potentially possible. I can probably operate on someone, you know, 100 kilometers away, but it's not just about moving the robot. Surgery is all, it's teamwork. You need your nurses, you need your technicians, you need your RT, you need your anesthesiologist, and you need the surgeon, the assistant. So and the robot is only one part of that. So what is practical is that with the robotic platform, if I wanted to proctor, if I needed to help someone that's actually doing the surgery, I can actually be 100 kilometers away and actually see how they're doing, and I can potentially help them, right? Help them through the surgery. That is possible. You know, you're talking about surgical robots, but there are a lot of robots, you know, available. And for instance, you know, a lot of hospitals in Japan, they have these robots that actually deliver the medication, you know, within the hospital. So that cuts the cost of human resources. You don't need, you know, someone to kind of deliver the medication, but the robot can do that accurately, you know, working together with the pharmacist. So there's, you know, many things that I think it's not just the surgical robots that will probably help our patients.
I see. And I'm sure the main message I think you want to provide to patients or the general public would be to trust the physician and trust their skills to use the robots to enhance their ability.
Yeah,
I see. Well, thank you, Dr. Yasufuku, for taking the time for us today. I know you're very busy, but your dedication to patients with your answers to our questions in this session definitely helped our audience in multiple ways. So thank you again, and we really appreciate your help.
You're welcome.